Okay, so this talk is about how do we model events as a graph. So to start us off, why do we want to model events as a graph in the first place? Well, there's a number of reasons, and maybe the most important ones of those are that we as a company have a mission to help people make better decisions. And when people think about complicated subjects, when they try to visualize their thoughts, what they do is they draw a graph. So if we can make the distance between this expression of your initial idea and the concept to how it's going to look when you implement a technical solution, then we believe this is going to help people make better decisions easier. And there's a few very pragmatic reasons as well. So for one, graph databases are designed for low latency performance, so they're better suited for some sorts of applications like recommendation engines, where you need to get a very quick response and then feed that back into some process. So they're much better suited for that than relational databases. And also, there's some questions when you're analyzing the data that are very hard to answer if your data is in the form of a table, but they're very easy to answer if your data is in the form of a graph. So for those reasons, it might be a good idea to model all of your event data as a graph. But how do you do that? If we're talking about events in a table, that's a very well understood model. We know what it's supposed to look like. It's always one line per event, and then you have as many columns as the number of dimensions you want to track for that event. And that's it. There isn't much room to deviate from that basic model. But that's not the case at all if you want to model your events as a graph. The way you could model a network as a graph is very well understood, and there's best practice for that, but not so much for events. So one option would be we could model each event as a node, and then we can have these nodes be connected with a next or previous relationship that just indicates what the sequence of events was. Or another approach would be to take the individual event and then deconstruct that into its constituent parts, and then come up with a model that's basically that has each entity be its own node, and then we can draw the relationships between these nodes. So for a page view event, we might have a model that has a user node and a page node, and these two are connected with a views relationship. Or we can mix these models. We can have a mixture of these. We can choose to model some things as nodes or as properties on nodes. Like an email address could be an individual node that's related somehow to the user node, or it could just be a property on the user node. And there isn't, it's not obvious how we should model events. There isn't much research done into what's the best way to do it. And when you look into modeling any data as a graph, the advice you usually get is model for the queries that you're going to be writing, because the way you model the data is going to dictate what queries you're going to run on that graph. Now again, that's in stark contrast to relational databases, where if you want to select the user ID and the page URL from your events table, this is the SQL query. And regardless of what events you're collecting, this is always going to be the SQL query for selecting two columns from a table. But if you model the data as a graph, you have many different queries that are going to give you the same result. So these are just two examples. If we model the event to have the different entities be nodes that are connected with relationships, We can match a pattern where we have a user node that views a page node, and then we can look for the ID property of that user node and for the URL property of the page node. Or if we modeled each event as its own node, then we can just match all the events and just look for the user ID property or the page URL property of that event. And both these queries are going to give you the exact same result, and it's the same result that you get with the SQL query. But in SQL, there's only one way we can do it. When we're building a graph, the shape of the graph dictates what the query needs to look like. So for that reason, it's quite important to think about how we're going to model the data if you want to get all of our event data in a graph database. Some time ago, we came up with this idea of this concept of an event grammar as a model to describe events, as a snapshot of the state of the different entities involved in that event at a particular time. So for each event, we know that there's a subject, or that's somebody who is doing the thing, and then there's something that's happening, and that happens at a particular time, and we can have many different additional dimensions. It could happen at a particular place, the weather could be sunny, or whatever other dimensions we might have for that event. Now, when we started thinking about modeling events as a graph, we realized that this is actually already a graph. It has the different entities as nodes, and there's relationships between these two entities. The main downside of this approach is that when you try to translate this if you try to shape this data to fit it into a table, you lose a lot of the richness that you get from this representation. So if we think of a video game where we have player one kills player two with a sword. If we imagine the table, there will be one column for player one, there will be one column for player two, there will be maybe one column to tell us that this is a kill event, there will be a timestamp, there will be a weapon column. But unless we know the domain, unless we know what that game is and how things work in it, there's no way for us to know who killed whom. Like, was player one the player that killed player two, or was it the opposite? Or maybe, this might sound absurd with this example, but if you absolutely have no idea of the domain, maybe it was the sword who killed both players. So when you try to get something that is a graph and fit it into a table, you lose a lot of those details. So to make those roles and the relationships explicit, we have to interpret the event and say this is what each of these entities is and what its role is in the event. So we can have a user, Alice, that views a page, one of the pages on the Snowplow Analytics website, and we can know that this user was using the Chrome browser, and we can also show that there was a referring page, Google, that referred to the page on the Snowplow website. But while this event is very visual and it's very easy to see what's happening and who's doing what and what the relationships are, it's hard to find all the events by the same user if that's the model you have for your event data. Don't worry if you're not too familiar with Neo4j. There's a few queries in the presentation, but I'm going to try to explain what they mean. So in this case, in this query, we're just matching a pattern where we have a user node, and we have a page node, and there's a views relationship between them. We match all those patterns across the graph, and then we're looking for only those patterns where the user email matches a specific value. And that way, we can find all the page views for that particular user. But what if we have multiple events? What if we also have download events and link clicks and player one kills, player two events? Like, then we'll need a separate query for each one of these events, because maybe they won't follow the exact same, they won't have the exact same structure. They'll have different relationships, they might have different entities. So we'll need different queries for each of those events, and then we need to find a way to aggregate those results. So while this approach gets us closer to where we want to be, it's not solving all our problems. Another approach we could explore is the event graph approach, where each event is a node, and in this graph, it's the gray nodes are the events, and we have these next or previous relationships between them, which basically just indicate the sequence of events. And then each event has outgoing relationships to all of its properties. So the first event will have a specific URL that it's linked to, and it will have a specific user. And the same for the other one. So now, with this sort of event, we can easily see all the events for that particular user, regardless of what they are and what other entities they have. Because the user will always be linked to those events. And it's very easy, if we have a graph that looks like that, to do a path analysis where we take a particular user and we see the whole path that they took to the application. But this model makes other queries harder. So what if we wanted to see all the pages visited by that user? We don't have a direct relationship between the user and the page. We always have to go through the event node to establish that relationship. So we can still do the query. Like we can match that pattern where we have an event in the center and this event has outgoing relationships to the different properties. One of them is the user, the other one is the page. But this adds additional, first of all, it's more complex. And this is a very simple example, but you can imagine that with more complicated events, you have to write more complicated queries. But also, it has performance implications. And if one of the reasons you want to model event data as a graph is because you're looking for low latency, you don't want any performance implications. You want to make sure that all your queries are as simple as can be and that they run efficiently. So we can also combine different elements of these events. We can denormalize the graph so that we represent the same data in different ways. So in this example, we still have the event nodes, the gray bits at the top, but and they still have those next and previous relationships between them. But each one of them, and also each one of those events has those outgoing relationships to all of its different attributes, like the referrer or the user or the browser that was used or the page that was seen. But then we also have relationships between those different properties. So we can see that the red referrer, which was Google, referred to this purple page on the Snowplow Analytics website. So this adds a lot of redundancy to the graph itself, but it makes the queries easier, and it means whatever question you're trying to answer, you'll always be able to write a query that's easy to understand, it's easy to write, and it is going to be performant. So now we can do both of the things that we wanted to do in one using the same model. So if we're interested to just see all the events for a particular user, or all the pages seen by a particular user. We can do that easily without having to go to the event node. And if we wanted to see a path, we can match any path for any specific user. So that's already sort of giving you an indication that putting your event level data in a graph database is not as easy as just selecting the database and just plugging the data in. You have to be very deliberate about how you're going to model it. The decisions you make when you come up with your model can hurt you down the line. If you make the wrong decision at the start, later on you might discover that a certain query that you really need to run is not very easy to do. And what do you do then? Do you just scrap the graph and start all over? It might be unavoidable. So why go through all of that trouble? We already have Redshift and Snowflake and BigQuery, and those are performing great. It could be that you can take the event level data, do some modeling in advance, maybe use Spark to do some modeling, and then only load the modeled data as a graph. Because maybe that data is much easier to model. Maybe it's no longer event level data. Maybe you've come up with some sort of network, even if it's just like, you know, a hierarchical one, that you can more easily model following established best practice. And then you can use that small graph to do those queries, those low latency queries. But then you get the problem that, okay, you're going to get insights from your graph, but you still have to link that data back to the relational database. And that's still a limiting factor if you're looking for low latency. So here's one example to sort of illustrate that. One popular usage of graph databases is for identity resolution. It's being used like for crime prevention, like busting crime networks. I think it was used also in like the Panama Papers story to link oligarchs to their money. And graphs are great for that. So here's an example of an identity resolution graph. We have the user nodes, the blue bits. We have the devices that are being used, are the yellow nodes. And we have the green nodes, which represent a network. So the network is identified by its IP address and by its physical location. The devices are identified either by a cookie we dropped on the domain, or if it's a mobile device, it could be the IDFA identifier of the device. And the user is identified by their email. And at first it looks like we have two users using two devices, and those devices hook up to the internet using three different networks. But actually, this is not very clear from this picture, but all these relationships and the ones between those nodes, these are alias of relationships. So this is the same user using two different emails, and this is the same device having two different, reporting two different values from the cookie we dropped, maybe because that user just purged cookies. And this is the same network with three different IP addresses, but it stays in the same place. So we're assuming it's the same network. So that's already that is valuable. It means whenever you see this email address, you know it also applies to the other one. But you have to link that back to your data. If your data is not in the same graph, you have to make that realization that this is the same user and then link it back somehow to the rest of the data, because you already have loads and loads of data about that user, like all of their history in your application. So you either have to write some custom process that pulls the graph for identity resolution and then goes back to the relational database to do other things, or you could have all the data in the graph database in one place, and then the identity resolution graph is just another set of relationships you have between your nodes. And once you figure out that this user is the same as the other user, you can compare the histories of these users. If one is incomplete, you can copy the bits over from the one that is more complete. And then whenever that user comes in your application, regardless of what email they're showing you, you always know the full history. All the models that you might have for them about recommending stuff to them or whatever you're doing with that data can be applied to that user based on the full history you have for them. I guess I already said that. That was all for me. I'm very happy to answer any questions.
Questions to Dillian.
That was an awesome presentation. I absolutely loved it. When you model the events and the flow, I was really interested in the sort of next and previous kind of aliases and edges within that network. Is one of the other use cases that you can, you know, if you've got people coming in, you've got like a registration or download event, your conversion event, which you're interested in, like a giving money event. Using like a handlebar analysis, can you use a graph like this and work out what the most common kind of route between those two bits are and what things you need people to do?
Yeah, I think it's one of the things that gets people most excited about using graphs for event level data, because you can chart those routes, and then you can start analyzing them to see, you know, if people take a specific path through the application, does that mean they're more likely to buy? If that's the case, can we encourage people to take that path through the application? And you know, does that change things? Will it make them more likely to buy? Or if we push more people down that route, is it going to sort of push down and like depress the propensity to buy? You can analyze all those things.
Is there clustering applications as well?
Especially with things like identity resolution, you can quickly, if you have a lot of events, just by looking at, you know, the number of different aliases for a single location, you can figure out that this is probably not a residential place. And then if you go and check it on Google Maps, indeed, it's a university. It is the case, but it is a benefit and it's also a curse. Because it doesn't give you a lot of stability. Like any snowplow user would know that we're huge fans of schemas. And of saying up front, this is what my event looks like, reject everything else. That's harder to enforce with a graph. And graph databases, by design, don't enforce that. Most of them don't make any difference between any two nodes or between any two relationships. It's on the developer who is building the model to enforce that. It's good for applications where you have all your, let's say you already have all your event level data modeled as a graph, and now you want to add identity resolution, then it's really useful because you're working with the nodes that are already in your graph. You're just creating additional relationships between them. But it could make it harder if a lot of your events that are the same type of event have a different pattern in the graph. It will be harder for you to match all of them.
So you mentioned using Node.js for them?
Neo4j.
Neo4j, yeah, exactly. How is it for analysis? Because to your point, it's good for real-time querying, but when you're saying, I want to find the average distance between these two events, does it work well for that, or?
Yes, yeah.
Okay.
It depends. It depends. So if you have two specific events in mind, then yes, it works well. Most graph databases, all probably, work very well when you can find some anchor points in the graph and start from there and just traverse that portion of the graph that is of interest to you. So if you have the events that you're interested in and you want to find the shortest distance between these two particular events, then yes, it's going to work very well. But if you're interested in some generalizations for the entire graph, then it's not going to work well at all. No graph database is optimized for that sort of query. You need a sort of a graph compute engine, something like, actually there's one that runs on Spark that can read in the graph and then do that computation for you.
So we have used graph frames from Spark to do this identity resolution. And it was great, but for 99% of the cases, but 1% you find people reusing fake email addresses or bugs in the cookie, yeah, IDs, and then you start in those.
Yeah. Oh yeah. But if you have a 99% success rate, that's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
Also. With recent developments, there's going to be a lot of people who say, I don't want to be tracked. So there's no way for you to know who they are just because they don't want you to know who they are.
Yeah.
For those that won't, it's not guaranteed to work 100% of the time, identity resolution that is. Your rules for how you decide that these two email addresses are the same person and these two IP addresses are the same network could be more or less sophisticated, which is also going to affect your accuracy.
Yeah, definitely.
I've got a question. You talked to Dillian about you can model events as a graph, you could also potentially take the output of the data modeling process to a much, much higher level representation, like session level or whatever, and model that as a graph. How promising do you think it'd be to actually run the data modeling process in the graph? So if you think about things like identity stitching, as an example you gave, and sessionization, having an event level graph, but running them on the graphs, effectively just accumulating more and more nodes and taking more to make it easier to navigate the graph. Is that a promising approach? Is that?
I have a gut feeling that it is, but it's still something we need to explore and experiment with. The reason I think it's so. One of the things that initially appeal when you see a graph is how visual it is. And it's like, I can see this person moving to these pages. But when you start working with real world data, um, as, as soon as you have even one snowplow page view event and you try to model that as a graph by denormalizing it, it becomes a mess. You can't see anything in that graph. It's not informative at all if you're just looking at the visual representation. But the thing is, it doesn't mean it's not useful. You can run queries that are going to give you the same results as any SQL query that you're going to run on a table that has these same events. So it doesn't necessarily only need to be visual for it to be useful. And if your data is already a graph, your data modeling will be easier because that's the native structure. You'll be writing queries that play to the strengths of that structure. Whereas if you have a table, there's lots of queries that become very, very hard. Like if you want to build a path that a person took to a website, a single graph query is going to match any path, regardless of whether it's only two pages that were visited or 200 pages that were visited. It's the same query. In SQL, for two pages, you have to do one join. For 200 pages, you have to do 199 joins. So it very quickly becomes just impossible to query. Now, in the graph, if you have a path with 200 nodes in it, you're not going to see anything because there's no way you can represent that on the screen in a way that makes sense to you. But you can write queries that are going to be useful working with that data. And then you no longer have to be limited by the length of that path, because you can have the same query for any size of path.
Yeah, I was just wondering, are there technical limitations of graph databases around something like the number of edges of any given node you can have, or is that just down to processing power or the imagination of the scientist model?
Well, there are technical limitations around walking all the edges in one go. If your graph is very big, it's no graph database can do that efficiently. But you can have a very big graph and you can still have very quick, very fast queries if you find the subgraph that interests you and your queries only run on that subgraph. So the difference between a graph with 1,000 nodes and a graph with 1 billion nodes, there's almost no difference. It scales very, very well.
Is it ever appropriate to load new relationships based on data? So for example, if you recorded every click event, but you forgot to record a purchase event, but you know that they added something to the basket, you know that they clicked the basket and made a purchase. Is it possible to then put that event back in under a new purchase relationship, and is it appropriate to do that?
It is possible. Whether it's appropriate is a question I struggle with. Because my initial starting point is the understanding that this is your source of truth. So you shouldn't be just mutating it, even if you think you're right, because you lose information. If you add that event, you lose the information that at some point this event wasn't there. But yes, it is entirely possible. You can, again, maybe not in a graph database, but certainly if you model the data as a graph and use a graph compute engine, you can use graph analysis to basically infer those missing nodes or relationships.
Yeah. What's your hunch on the kind of a killer app that will make people want to bring their whole kind of event store into a graph database?
I have no idea. I'm still looking for it. I think identity resolution is very promising. I think attribution modeling is very promising. Although with attribution modeling, there's a risk because people see graphs and they think, oh, Markov chains, which is not necessarily true. Like the sequence of steps you take in that journey does matter. They're not discrete events. What happens before influences what happens after. So it's not quite so clear cut. But it's one thing that there's a lot of enthusiasm about.
It's good for recommendations as well.
Yeah, recommendations as well.
Yeah.
If it's already on S3, you might want to look at AWS Neptune, which is the new cloud-native graph database. I guess it's going to be very easy to get the data from S3 to Neptune. I think, so Neo4j for sure has an integration for AWS. I don't know how hard it is to get data from S3 to Neo4j. You have to do the modeling on the fly, but that's something that applies in both cases.
Mm-hmm. So the tooling you use to model just kind of depends on the database that you're writing, the graph database you're writing to?
I think it depends on what other things you already have in your stack. And what tools are the people who are going to work with this, what are they used to? So Neo4j has this query language called Cypher, which is very approachable. If you know SQL, you will immediately understand how Cypher works, and it's very intuitive. Other databases use languages that are more Java-like. So if you have a lot of very strong Java developers, they'll feel right at home there.
If you use Spark, I would recommend graph frames, especially if you want to do analysis, you can do page rank or connected component, this kind of thing, like what's the longest path quite easily. Of course, it doesn't work for low latency. And it doesn't have a lot of UI unless you use Databricks.
So it doesn't have very large.
So usually you work on the command line on Spark, but you can, if you use Databricks, which has got a notebook-like interface, you can then start graphing.
Yeah, really long in the beginning of the conversation, you were talking about how one of the advantages is for people who might not have an implicit knowledge of the data in the relational database, for example. With the graph database, it's easier to understand what's in there. How does that play out for like a representation? Do you present some type of key or legend of what all the nodes and edges are, or how does that differ in the relationship?
Well, no, you just show the graph, and then each node has a name or a label, and you can see all of its properties. You can see the relationships between the nodes. You can see what those relationships are called. That's actually a good point about why it's valuable to have the data in this way, because very often the people who make the decisions are not the people who do the technical implementation. So their understanding, it's much easier for them to explain what they want if things are represented as a graph. And it's much easier for them to give feedback once you have the implementation. Much easier for them to give feedback on whether that implementation matches their original idea.
Thank you very much, Dillian.